हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, गुड मॉर्निंग, वेलकम बैक. सो माई सेल्फ पुष्पेंद्र सिंह एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद द डेली करंट अफेयर्स फॉर द 31st ऑफ दिसंबर 2020 एंड दिस वुड बी योर लास्ट डे फॉर द ईयर. ऑल राइट, एंड आई विल बी कवरिंग द डेली करंट अफेयर्स थ्रू दिस प्रोग्राम. ऑल राइट, सो यू विल हैव द डेली करंट अफेयर्स न्यूज एनालिसिस. यू कैन रेफर the two important newspapers. The first is The Hindu, okay, and the second is Indian Express. You can refer any of these newspapers or you can read both of them also. Both are equally good. You can refer anyone, whichever suits you the best. Okay, so let's begin with the daily current affairs for 31st of December 2020. All right. So this would be your first news which is coming. So this news is basically related to the Akash missile system. Okay, so the news which is there is related to the export of Akash missile system. Okay, so the Union Cabinet, which is basically headed by Prime Minister Modi, which is basically headed by the PM Modi, basically approved the export of Akash missile system. Okay, so but you must understand, this export of Akash missile system would enable the, you know, some sort of a defense related, you know, the export of those items, and which has basically also created a committee for the faster approval of the defense export. Okay, so this committee basically comprises of the defense minister, external affairs minister, as well as the national security advisor. So this committee would look into the issues which is related to the faster approval of defense exports. And this would enable the defense related items export from India. Okay, so let's understand the brief about the Akash missile. Okay, so Akash is nothing but the surface to air missile. Okay, surface to air missile means it will be propelled from the surface, and it will be hitting the target in the air. Okay, so it will have the surface to air missile with the range of 25 kilometers, so it cannot go beyond 25 kilometers. And this missile was indigenously built. Okay, and this was inducted into the Indian Air Force in 2014, and subsequently the army version of the Akash missile was inducted with the Indian Army in 2015. Okay, and this is the most important missile system in India because it has over 96% of indigenization, which means it has completely, or it has almost 100% made by the India. Okay, and you must understand, there were many such demands from the neighboring countries regarding the expression of the interest for this missile system, right? So these expression of the interest was shown by many friendly countries. Okay, so to understand their demands and to fulfill their demands, the Union Cabinet basically approved the export of the Akash missile system to those friendly countries. Okay, now this approval would ultimately facilitate the Indian manufacturers to ultimately participate, right, in this, you know, process of exporting this Akash missile by various countries. So far, you must understand, so far India is basically exporting various parts and the components of the defense related, the instruments or the parts. But this is one such step which was taken by the Union Cabinet to export this big platform, which is also the most important step in order to provide the, you know, for the ultimate returns to the defense industry. And this initiative would ultimately help the country to improve the defense products. And this would also enable the country to make those defense products the globally competitive. Because you must understand, in terms of the export market of, or in terms of the percentage of the exports from the India, when we compare in terms of the defense related items, it is minimal. So by taking this step, or by exporting this Akash missile system to the friendly countries, we will certainly you know, fulfill this gap of, you know, having the minimal export of the defense related items to the global market. All right, so this would basically enable the India to make those defense related items are globally competitive in the nature. All right, and this is the picture where you can see the Akash missile is basically fired. So Akash is surface to air missile which is having the range of 25 kilometers. All right, the second is Sahayak NG. So what is this Sahayak NG? So you must understand, the Sahayak NG is nothing but it is a container which can be dropped from the air. So it is air dropped container. So what is the necessity of having this air dropped container? Right, when you drop, when you, for example, if you have the ship or if you have any sort of aircraft carrier, right, for example, 2000 kilometers or 3000 kilometers away from the coast, okay, and you need some of the emergency deployment of certain critical engineering items, right, you can basically put them into this container and you can basically deliver over there. Okay, if you don't have any place to deliver, and that will have the another added advantage is that it basically provide, you know, it basically, you know, removes the necessity of, you know, taking off all sort of your operational logistics, right? During that, you know, taking out the ship out of, you know, the coast. So it will ultimately remove that bondage of taking all materials along with that. So it will ultimately lighten the, you know, the weight of the ship also. So the Defense Research and Development Organization, DRDO, along with Indian Navy, okay, conducted the successful trial of Sahayak NG. So it is nothing but the indigenously designed and the developed airdropped container. And this airdropped container are basically dropped from one Indian aircraft, which is IL-380, IL-38SD aircraft, which is also belongs to the Indian Navy of the coast of Goa. And it has been successfully tested. Okay, now this trial, which was conducted by the Indian Army to enhance the operational logistics capability, as I told you, because when you have to provide this critical engineering stores to the ship, okay, when the ship is basically, you know, have been deploying, say, for 2,500 kilometers away from the coast, it will be very easy if you have such type of, you know, airdropped containers and you put basically all those critical engineering stores in this container and it can be easily delivered. So ultimately it will enhance the operational logistics capability, okay, to those ships which are far more away from the coast. All right, and it will basically definitely reduce the requirement of the ship to come close to the coast to collect the spares and the stores. Obviously the ship every time has to visit to the coast to collect those stores. But if you have such type of, you know, container which can be dropped from the air, right, the necessity of coming every time to the ship to the store is basically ruled out. So it will be beneficial for the operational logistics capability of Indian Navy ships in the deeper part of the oceans. Okay, now the two DRDO laboratories, one is the Naval Science and Technological Laboratory, which is located at Visakhapatnam, and ADRD laboratory, which is located at Agra, were basically involved in the development of this Sahayak NG container, which is indigenously built. And it was built along with the industrial partner called MS Avantel for GPS integration. Okay, so which means the Sahayak integration, Sahayak NG is also have the GPS integrated system. So it is basically nothing but an advanced version of Sahayak MK1, which was previously built. Okay, so this newly developed or the new version of the Sahayak MK1, which is also known as Sahayak NG, is basically the newly developed GPS aided airdropped container. So the previous version does not have this one, so it has the GPS aided airdropped container, so that it will have the capability to carry a payload, right? So payload means it can carry that weight up to the 50 kg, right? And it can be dropped from any heavy aircraft so that it can basically reach to the desired location. Okay, and this Sahayak NG, which is airdropped container, has the satellite based reporting terminal. Okay, so wherever it will, you know, it will basically settle down, it can send those signals, and which will provide the precise location, okay, of this container, and which will enable the ship to ship in the distress to pick up the critical stores. So you must understand, it will basically have the GPS aided, you know, the satellite antenna, which is also known as the satellite based reporting terminal. Okay, this would enable the precise location of GPS integrated, you know, the airdropped container, and in that during the distress time, the ship can easily find out this, you know, the airdropped container which has the GPS signal weighted with it, and it can easily be located. So this is basically, you know, advanced version of the Shahak MK1, so which is fitted with, or which is integrated with the GPS, you know, GPS locator, so that it can be easily find out in the deeper part of the oceans also. All right, so this is the news which is there. So you must understand, what is the news? The news is that the Sahayak NG is nothing but the airdropped container which is integrated with the GPS technology, okay, and it has been successfully tested from the Indian Navy aircraft, and this Sahayak NG would enable the Indian Army to enhance the operational logistics capability, right, when the ship in the distress, and it can basically enable the Indian Army to send some of the critical logistics or some of the critical, you know, consignments or critical engineering stores to the ship, right, when the ship is more than 2000 kilometers away, or when the ship is away from the coast, and it will basically reduces or removes or ruled out, you know, the need of the ship to come to the store to collect those stores. All right. Next, the Argentina's laws on the abortion. Okay. So Argentina, first of all, you must understand, it is a South American countries. It is a South American countries. It is located in the South America. So in a few Christian countries, right, they have some Christian belief that the abortion is illegal over there. Okay. So the abortion is, you know, illegal over there, and they consider it is anti-religious practice, okay, because it is, you know, some of the principal cardinal principles of the Christianity is basically is opposing the basically, you know, abortion in these countries. So the abortion was basically illegal in those countries. The Argentina was one such country. All right, now you must understand that because of these abortions which are not allowed in certain countries, there were many deaths, especially the pregnant women died, you know, because of the complications of the pregnancy, because they did not allow, or the law did not allow them to abort the child, and it will have, you know, some of the implications of the health also on the woman. But the Argentina Congress this time legalized the abortions up to the 14th week of pregnancy. Okay, so this is one of the important step taken by the Argentina's Congress, right? It will be a groundbreaking decision in the country, and that will have the most, you know, repercussions in those region also. And the Argentina has the world most restrictive abortion laws also. But this time, the Argentina Congress has legalized the abortion up to the 14th week of pregnancy. All right, so it will be a historic change, and it will be, you know, witnessing such changes also beyond Argentina, especially in the Latin American countries, which also have the belief that the abortion is basically against certain practices of the religion. So they do not allow the abortion to be occur. All right, now prior to bringing that law, the abortion was only permitted in the case-to-case basis. For example, during the rape, okay, or during the woman's health, when it is very serious, or during the critical time, the abortion was allowed. Okay, otherwise the abortion was not allowed. But activists, right, in those countries, you know, campaigning for the years together and calling for the, you know, reforms in this practice, and this law was existing in the country since 1921 onward, and many more deaths occurred because of this restrictive practices which is occurring in a certain countries, right? Now, this bill calls for the greater autonomy for the women, because this would enable the woman, right, the woman's control over their own bodies, okay, whether to bear the children or not to bear the children, okay? So the no government can dictate that you don't have the right to the abort the children, okay? So this is what is something this is most important. And also the woman's control over their reproductive rights, okay? If any woman do not want to give the birth to the children, who can force the woman to give the birth? Okay, so certain practices are also against the human rights also. Okay, and it will provide certainly the better healthcare to the pregnant women and the young mothers also in this process. All right, so this is basically, you know, certain changes which are made by the Argentina this time. So Argentina, as I told you, it is basically the Southern American country. It is located in the South American continent. All right. Next, the India-Bhutan Memoranda of Understanding on the cooperation in the peaceful use of the outer space. Okay, so what is that? So Memoranda of Understanding means it is certainly exactly not an agreement, but it is, you know, the readiness on the cooperation for the peaceful use of the outer space. So both Union Cabinet basically approved the Memoranda of Understanding between the Government of India and the Government of Bhutan, right, especially in the cooperation for the peaceful use of outer space. Okay, and this MOU was signed basically on November 19, 2020, and subsequently the Union Cabinet has approved this MOU, which was signed on 19th of November 2019 at the Bangalore, and which has been successfully exchanged. Okay, now what is the significance of this MOU? The significance of MOU is that both India and the Bhutan, right, can pursue the cooperation in the potential interest areas, right, especially in the outer space region. For example, right, the remote sensing technologies, okay, of the Earth, the satellite communications, okay, the satellite based navigations, the space sciences and planetary explorations, the use of spacecraft and the space systems and the ground systems, and application of the space technology for exploring the space, right? So ultimately, the items belongs to the outer space. So it is nothing but the MOU which is related to the outer space. Okay, this MOU would lead to set up a joint working group. The joint working group basically, you know, consisting of the both the members of the countries. For example, the joint working group would have the members of the ISRO or the Department of Space, okay? And it will also have the members from the Ministry of Information and the Communications of the Government of Bhutan. And these working group would ultimately would work further, right? And it will carry out the plan of action, including the time frame and the means of implementation of MOU. So this joint working group would ultimately takes the decision, and it will further, work out for the plan of action, which will be based on the implementation and the time frame of such MOU. All right. So this MOU is basically related to the cooperation, the peaceful use of outer space, especially in the areas of remote sensing, satellite communications, the satellite-based navigations, the space science, planetary explorations, the use of spacecraft, okay, the space systems and the ground systems, and ultimately the application of space technology for the exploration and the research and development. All right. Next, ASHA India. Okay, so let's understand. What is this ASHA means? First of all, the ASHA means Affordable Sustainable Housing Accelerators, okay, India. So it is a full form of the ASHA India. It is nothing but the Affordable Sustainable Housing Accelerators, okay? So what are these ASHA India, first of all? So by name, it is suggesting that affordable, sustainable, it is understood. But what is this housing accelerators, okay? So it is nothing but, right, those entrepreneurs which ultimately provide certain domestic research or entrepreneurship, right, by providing certain, you know, the incubation or acceleration support to the potential future technologies so that these technologies can be integrated into the sustainable housing, you know, sustainable housing process, so that it can be easily and it can be affordably available to the people of this country. So they are nothing but the entrepreneurs which provide the domestic research and the entrepreneurship, right? And this will ultimately provide certain future technologies which can be integrated in the affordable housing to the common people of this country. So they are nothing but the ASHA India or affordable sustainable housing accelerators. Okay, all right. So what is the news which is coming out is that every year, right, the Narendra Modi, Prime Minister Narendra Modi would announce the winners under the ASHA India, which is affordable sustainable housing accelerators India, and would give out these awards for the excellence in the implementation of the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Urban. So the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana is also one of the important yojana which would provide the affordable housing to the urban people, right, which are residing in the urban areas. And these accelerators are nothing but the incubators or the entrepreneurs which provide certain domestic research and entrepreneurship, which will ultimately provide certain support to those future technologies and which can be integrated into the affordable housing in India. All right. So under ASHA India initiative, 5 ASHA India centers have been set up, right? And these ASHA India centers would provide the incubation and acceleration support to the, you know, the sustainable housing in our country. And these technologies which are provided by this ASHA India, right, or the process or the materials which are identified through this initiative would provide a major fillip, because you must understand the technology integration even in the building construction, right? When you making the building, right, obviously you need to build those buildings which are more affordable in the nature, right, which are less energy consumptive, because you need to design those buildings, right, in the various aspects. It should be, you know, it should be livable, it should provide the optimum environment, it should reduce the consumption of the electricity, and so on and so forth. And it should also use that material which can be locally available, and this material should not also provide certain, you know, the ill effect. For example, certain materials are also the greenhouse gas emitters. So you need to identify those technologies, you need to identify those process, you need to identify those materials which can be identified and which can be integrated into the sustainable housing, you know, mechanism, and which will provide a major flip to those entrepreneurs or to those young mind, right, or those innovators or startups which can also use or which can also provide this technology. All right, so this is just in diagram. Okay, next news is related to again housing projects. So it is lighthouse projects. So it is not the lighthouse which is built nearby shore. So it is lighthouse. So it is the house construction. So it's a lighthouse projects. Okay, all right. So you must understand, it is related to the housing. It is related to the housing needs. All right. So the news which is coming out is that Prime Minister Narendra Modi will lay the foundation stone of the lighthouse projects, okay, under the Global Housing Technology Challenge India. Okay, so you must understand, the Prime Minister will ultimately lay the foundation for the lighthouse projects, okay, which will ultimately under the Global Housing Technology Challenge India, which is also called the GHTC India, at the 6 sites and which are located in the 6 states on the 1st January 2021. Okay, so these lighthouse projects which will be laid the foundation stone, right, by the Narendra Modi, which will showcase the best of new age alternative global technologies. Okay, and this alternative global technologies and materials and the process, especially in the construction sector, for the first time in the country at such large scale, because this would have, you know, thousands of the house will be constructed, and this constructions under GHTC India would emphasize to provide an ecosystem for adoption of innovative technology, which would be, you know, more suitable and which would be more I know the optimum in terms of the economies of the scale in the housing construction sector, which will be integrated in the holistic manner. So these sites which are going to be laid the foundation stone by Prime Minister Narendra Modi. So these lighthouse projects are being constructed at the five sites at the five states on the 1st January 2021. So these five sites are the Indore, which is located in the state of Madhya Pradesh, Rajkot, which is located in the state of Gujarat, Chennai, which is located in the state of Tamil Nadu, Ranchi, which is located in the state of Jharkhand, Olight, Agartala in the state of Tripura, Lucknow in the state of Uttar Pradesh. So these are nothing but, you know, these are nothing but the you know, the laying stones where the six sites would be developed in terms of these lighthouse projects. And here the global technologies and the materials and the process would be integrated first time in the country to such a large scale, right? So it will be a greater innovative technology which will be integrated in those cities. All right. And you must understand this lighthouse project comprises around 1,000 houses at each location, okay? So it will have 1,000 houses along with allied infrastructural facilities, for example, the swimming pool, like gymnasiums and etc. and so forth. But each lighthouse project will have 1,000 houses, right, at each location. And this will be developed with the innovative technologies. And these projects will demonstrate and deliver the ready-to-live houses at expedited place within the 12 months. All right. So it will be promising, you know, for providing this the ready-to-live houses within the 12 months, right? And as you compare, you know, normal brick house, which will take, you know, much greater time sometime. And these houses which are constructed will be more economical. They will be more sustainable and there will be high quality and they will be durable also. So these houses would be more economical, sustainable and durable also, and which would ultimately fulfill the deficit of the housing needs in those cities where the housing deficit is much more. All right. So you know that in the urban areas, you have the shortage of the urban dwellings or the shortage of those, you know, the affordable housings. So this would ultimately fulfill these deficits which are there in the urban areas regarding the urban dwellings. All right. So this is the news which is related to the lighthouse project, which will be laid foundation by Honorable Prime Minister of India, Narendra Modi. All right. Next, dedicated freight corridor. So let's understand this dedicated freight corridor. So this news is basically flashing because the dedicated freight corridor is nothing but, you know, a corridor where only the freight would be transported. Freight means only the goods will be transported. So it will be a dedicated lanes where only the goods trains will be moved, right? So this dedicated, you know, corridor is nothing but the dedicated freight corridor. Okay. So when we say the dedicated freight corridor consisting of two arms, okay, it will have the two arms. The first arm, which we call basically the Eastern Dedicated Freight Corridor. Okay. The Eastern Dedicated Freight Corridor is the longest one, which is basically 1,839 kilometers long. And it is basically starting from the Sonewal, Ludhiana in the Punjab. And it basically ends at the Dhankuni, which is located in the West Bengal. So it basically runs from the Ludhiana in the Punjab to the West Bengal. And it is 1,839 kilometers long stretch. Okay. And the second arm, which is the Western Dedicated Freight Corridor, which is shorter and which is of length of 1500 kilometers only. And it basically starts from the Dadri, which is a place in the Uttar Pradesh, to the Jawaharlal Nehru Port Trust in Mumbai, in Maharashtra. And this Western Dedicated Freight Corridor would touch almost all major ports along the way. So these two sections or these two arms of dedicated freight corridor, which would enable the commercial operations, right, to take place to the greater level. So what is the news regarding the dedicated freight corridor is that the Prime Minister Narendra Modi inaugurated 351 kilometer section of the dedicated freight corridor. The dedicated freight corridor, right, between the Khurja, right, and Bhaupur in the Uttar Pradesh for the commercial operations. For the commercial operations, right. So let's understand or let's see the news. Let's see the news. So here, the 351 kilometer section stretch between the Khurja, right, in the north and the new Bhaupur near Kanpur was open to use, right? So this is also a section, right? Or there is also one section which is under construction routing right now, and which will ultimately connect the Dadri in the Uttar Pradesh to Khurja. And this section which will connect the eastern dedicated freight corridor to western dedicated freight corridor, and the section which was opened by PM Modi, which was built or which was constructed at the cost of 5,750 crore rupees, and this was based on the loan which was received by the government of India from the World Bank. Okay, so major difference is that this is the part of basically, you know, the eastern dedicated freight corridor. The eastern dedicated freight corridor is mainly built up of the loan which is received from the World Bank. The western dedicated freight corridor, which is mainly funded by the Japan Industrial Cooperation Agency, or which is also called JICA, Japan Industrial Cooperation Agency, okay, which is an agency of the government of Japan. All right, so let's look at the diagram of dedicated freight corridor. So I was telling about this dedicated freight corridor. So it has two arms. So this is basically nothing but the eastern dedicated freight corridor. So as I told you that it starts from Sahnewal from Punjab to the Dhankuni in West Bengal. So the intermediate stations, you can also check it out. Okay, the intermediate stations, for example, New Sarhind, you know, the New Khurja, you know, the New Bhaupur, then New Kanpur, New Mughalsarai, New Sasaram, New Sonar, New Koderma, okay, New Khana, New Dhamo. Now, which was opened recently by the PM Narendra Modi, is the section which start from the New Khurja to the New Bhaupur. Okay, so you can see here, this is the section which was opened. So it is 351 kilometers long section. So in between you have the station, you have the places called New Dhankun, New Hathras, New Tundla, New Makhanpur, New Bhadan, New Ekdil, New Adhalda, New Kachausi, and New Bhaupur. So these are the few places which are there in between. Okay, and this is basically western dedicated freight corridor which connect the Dadri in the Uttar Pradesh to JNPT, which is a port trust in the Mumbai or in the Maharashtra region. All right, so this is the diagram. You can also make sure that the diagram is properly used for your understanding also. Okay, next news is regarding anemia. So let's understand. Okay, so the news which is coming out from the reports of the National Family Health Survey. Okay, so this National Family Health Survey, which was conducted in 2019 and 2020, okay, and this has released the report regarding the Indian women and the children, right, regarding the status of anemia. It is basically a shortage of red blood cells, or when you have the paucity of red blood cells or the quantity of hemoglobin in the body. Okay, so the women and the children are overwhelmingly anemic. That means they have been found a normal red blood cells which are lower than the normal number, or the quantity of the hemoglobin found to be below than what is required to be having in the normal healthy body. Okay, now if those red blood cells or the hemoglobin is found to be lesser, the person can feel tired, the person feel themselves cold, in the dizzy condition, irritable, and the shortage of the breath, and there are many other symptoms also. And why this shortage of the anemia occurred? The shortage of the anemia occurred because of the imbalanced diet or because of the absence of the nutrient. For example, if you do not consume the enough diet which has the enough iron or folic acid or vitamin B12, right, you will have the anemia, or you will have the greater chance of having anemia. So you require certain diet which will have the iron, folic acid, and vitamin B12. And there are certain conditions also that may lead to the anemia. For example, this is what is natural, which happens during the pregnancy, because you need, you know, the extra nutrient during the pregnancy also. Then heavy periods, if your periods are very regular and heavy, and blood disorders like cancers, inherited disorders, and other infectious diseases also cause the anemia in the women and the children. All right. Let's understand the status of anemia in our history. So 15 out of 22 states, okay, and union territory, more than half of the children are anemic. So that means more than 50% of the children in those 15 states are having the paucity of the hemoglobin, or the deficit of the hemoglobin also. And more than 50% of the women are also anemic in these 14 states and the union territories. Okay. And proportion of the anemic children and the women is comparatively lower, especially in certain union territories and the states. For example, in the Lakshadweep, in the Kerala, Meghalaya, Manipur, Mizoram, Nagaland, right? So you can say predominantly the northeastern states have comparatively lesser anemic children and the women, apart from the Lakshadweep and the Kerala. And it is higher in the Ladakh region, Gujarat region, Jammu and Kashmir region, West Bengal, and among others. All right. So this is the status of anemia in our country. It is the status of anemia in our country. All right. So you can see this from this diagram that this hand looks a bit reddish. Okay. And these are red blood cells. So you can check it out by looking at your hand. So it is a normal hand which has enough red blood cells or hemoglobin. Okay, the white is basically platelets, and these whites are nothing but your white blood cells. Okay, so these white blood cells are there, but there is less number of the red blood cells, which is also the symptom of anemia. Okay, let's understand the Shule-Panesar Wildlife Sanctuary. So first of all, the Shule-Panesar Wildlife Sanctuary is located in the state of Gujarat. So it is located in the western Satpura range, right? Especially the south of the Narmada River. So this Shule-Panesar Wildlife Sanctuary is nothing but it is a protected area in the state of Gujarat, and which is located in the western Satpura range, south of Narmada River. Okay. Now, what is the news which is coming regarding the Shule-Panesar Wildlife Sanctuary? Recently, the tribal communities which is residing in this Shule-Panesar Wildlife Sanctuary, the tribal communities basically urged the Prime Minister Narendra Modi to withdraw the center's notification regarding classifying 121 villages around the Shule-Panesar Wildlife Sanctuary in the Narmada district as an eco-sensitive zone. Okay, so what is the problem with declaring of such 121 villages as a eco-sensitive zone? So first of all, if you are declaring the villages, right, as an eco-sensitive zone, that means you are making the state government as a co-owner of the land which is lying in and around the Shule-Panesar sanctuary, first of all. So first of all, the process has initiated to include the state government as a co-owner. Okay. The second thing is that the tribal communities is in the suspicion that by providing this notification, the land which is falling in the eco-sensitive zone, right? So this land, first of all, would not be transferred to the non-agricultural purpose, right? Or for the commercial purpose or industrial purpose or the residential purpose. So which may hampering certain, you know, developmental needs. And even if you want to transfer that land to non-agricultural operations, say for industrial purpose, for residential purpose, or for commercial purpose, it can be done only after the approval from the state government. That means by notification, you are ultimately making the state government as a stakeholder or as a co-owner of this land in the Shule-Panesar Wildlife Sanctuary. And there is one more law, which is called PISA Act 1996. So PISA Act 1996 is nothing but the Panchayat extension to those scheduled areas. you know the fifth schedule and the sixth schedule areas where the Panchayati Raj Act or 73rd Constitutional Amendment Act or 74th Constitutional Amendment Act do not apply. So for those fifth schedule and the sixth schedule areas, the central government has enacted a separate act which basically enforced certain provisions of the Panchayat to those schedule areas. And this act is known as Panchayat Extension to the Schedule Areas Act 1996. Now, many tribal communities also feel that the provisions which are there under this PISA Act 1996, right, which will not be implemented, right, for those areas which falls in the Schedule 5 of the Constitution. And ultimately, over the period of the time, the provisions of these Panchayats Extension to the Schedule Areas Act 1996, which will be diluted, and that will ultimately, ultimately exploit those tribal communities which will be residing in the tribal areas. And this will enable the state government to dislocate or to move away or to basically, dislocate those poor tribal communities from the Shulpaneshwar Wildlife Sanctuary, which is residing in this wildlife sanctuaries since generations together. Okay, so this is the scene of Shulpaneshwar Wildlife Sanctuary. Okay, next is attachment of the property. So this is the last news for today's newspaper. Okay, so Enforcement Directorate, right, has issued the order for the attachment of the several properties. Attachment ka matlab hota hai, it is not confiscation. Confiscation ka matlab hota hai chheen lena. Attachment ka matlab, it is a provisional term where the property will be taken over by the governmental agencies for the limited period of the time, right? And if those offenses is not proved, this property may be released back to those owner. Okay, so here the attachment was done by the Enforcement Directorate, which is the Government of India's agencies, right? This property belongs to the former Jammu and Kashmir Chief Minister Farooq Abdullah in connection with the money laundering in the Jammu and Kashmir Cricket Association case. Okay, the case was filed in which the Umar Abdul Farooq Abdullah was accused, and it has been accused that a certain money laundered in the name of the Farooq Abdullah, and the property was ultimately purchased by this laundered money by the Farooq Abdullah in the Jammu and Kashmir. So the Enforcement Directorate basically attach this property so that any property which is purchased from this ill-gotten money, right, from this money laundered can be put into in the right domain. All right, so you must understand the statutory provision is that the ED or Enforcement Directorate order is valid only for 180 days. Okay, and during that 180 days there is one more authority which is known as adjudicating authority. This adjudicating authority would have to confirm this ED's order. Okay, if the adjudicating authority do not confirm the order given by Enforcement Directorate, okay, under Prevention of Money Laundering Act, PMLA, right, this property would be automatically, released back to the owner. Okay, if it is confirmed, it will basically, keep on attached, right, and accused here, the Farooq Abdullah will get the time of 45 days. So within 45 days, he can challenge this attachment order given by the Enforcement Directorate in the Appellate Tribunal and subsequently in the High Court and the Supreme Court also. And based on that order, the process would ultimately follow. All right. So this is the news which is, related to the 31st of December 2020. So I wish you all of you, right, the Happy New Year. All right. So Happy New Year 2020-21. Okay. And from my side and from the future IAS classes, I wish you Happy New Year for all of you. And I wish you all the best for the new year 2021. So thank you very much for attending this class. Thank you.